I'd like to say, before introducing our speaker, I'd like to say a word or two about the Neff Lecture Series. This is the James R. Neff Lecture Series. My name is Brett DePaola. I'm in the physics department. And I want to say a word about Dr. Neff. Dr. Neff was an internationally known and recognized orthopedic surgeon. And he was a professor at University of Nebraska Medical Center in Omaha. He was also former chair of the Department of Orthopedic Surgery. And Dr. Neff, his connection here is he received his undergraduate degree from K-State in 1962. He then went on to KU Medical School and graduated from there in 1966. During his time at KU, Dr. Neff developed a surgical implant, which included a titanium nail, essentially. The initial use of this device was to reconstruct segmented portions of the body that in cancer patients. And today, this device is still known and still used. It's known as the Neff nail. And it's in widespread use for many conditions beyond its initial use. In 1995, Dr. Neff established the James R. Neff Lectureship in Physics. And this lectureship shall, quote, perpetuate and honor Everett and Florine Neff, parents of James R. Neff, and Janet K. Neff Standish, James's sister. It's further intended to represent Dr. Neff's gratitude for the opportunities and education that he received at Kansas State University, and to verbally acknowledge Florine and Everett Neff as benefactors of the Institution of Higher Learning. And this lecture series is now funded by an endowment established with a bequest from Dr. Neff. Sadly, Dr. Neff died in 2005, and he is buried in Arlington National Cemetery. So it's my great pleasure to introduce this year's Neff speaker, Professor Michael Ranney. He's a professor of psychology, which is, I think, a first for a physics lecture. Dr. Ranney got his bachelor's degree at University of Colorado Boulder in psychology and molecular, cellular, and developmental biology. So already pretty broad. Got his master's and PhD from University of Pittsburgh in experimental cognitive psychology, and is now a professor of psychology at University of California-Berkeley. Dr. Ranney heads Berkeley's reasoning research group. They also generate curricula, methods, and artificial intelligence software designed to improve rational thinking. He works in areas as diverse as physics and biology and touches topics such as abortion and immigration. Dr. Ranney was a Spencer Fellow of the National Academy of Education and the Spencer Foundation, and a University of California Regents Junior Faculty Fellow. And the part I like best, his first publication was in an applied physics journal. So, without taking any more time away from Dr. Ranney's lecture, except for one little detail, just so that you all get to see it before you run out if things do go over.
Wow.
It's my great pleasure to present this nice plaque.
Thank
for
you.
Professor Ranney. I'll read it for you. It's it says on it the 2017 James R. Neff Public Lecture, and it's presented to Dr. Ranney, and it has the title of his talk. And it's dated, of course. Suitable for hanging in a prominent location in your
definitely. House. Wow, thanks so much.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. This is great. Wow. Super. Wow, I wasn't expecting this. This is fantastic. The folks back home are going to be impressed, I'll tell you. That's great. Well, I'm really honored to be here for the Neff Lecture, and so thankful that you're having me out here. And I certainly hope that this raises some interesting ideas, and I look forward to, hopefully we'll have some good time for questions later, and I look forward to chatting with folks perhaps individually after that. So I'll launch in. As you can kind of tell, I did this a little trepidatiously, but I thought I might as well invite any climate skeptics, because in theory, the information I offer would be useful for them. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in just a little bit as well. Just to give you a sense of what I mean by that and to contextualize it. The real title, as you can see, is sort of Raising Conservatives and Liberals, Acceptance of Human-Caused Global Warming with Information. And, you know, this work is done with a whole host of folks. These are just some of the current and past reasoning group folks that have helped me. And so all praise to them for this. And these are a couple of references from some recent work that actually give you a sense of some of the more journalese sorts of experiments and so forth that that we do with our empirical work. And you can have a look at that, those of you interested. So I'll dive ahead with this caveat. So please hear me out. I am not a commie. I realize you think that I would show up in my full tie-dye regalia from Berkeley and whatnot. But I want to contextualize a little bit because, you know, in psychology, Ortgeist is important, like the sense of place and all. And so I think it's a sense for me to give you an idea of where I'm coming from so that you might have a sense maybe I'm not all that different from you. For one thing, I've been to Kansas many times. It's not my first visit. And my great-grandfather was born in Colorado, so I grew up there as well. One of my best friends has a ranch not too far across the border in Nebraska and runs this modest family farm there. My dad was grew up on a farm and gave me tips about farming if ever I needed to farm. I grew up barrel racing, and I shot firearms, and I've attended stock car races, demolition derbies. And I do believe in a free speech for all. So I'm not one of those folks that is trying to quell conservatives coming to the Berkeley campus. I think they should come and we should hear them. I come from a tradition where people really cared about the United States for one reason or another. I wouldn't be here if it weren't for the United States. I love it, and I want everyone to love the United States. And I am a huge fan. You won't find someone rooting more for the US than the Olympics. And I consider myself a patriot. So I say that because I'm also someone who assesses data and collects data, and so I'm going to provide that. So I want to at least contextualize that in case you're not on board with climate change. I'm hoping that some of this information will help you consider getting on board. And if you are on board with accepting climate change, I hope this will provide you a little bit more of a firmament in case you run into folks who are not yet to that point. So I want to start by giving you actually a phenomenal sense of what I provide some of our participants in our experiments. So I'm going to show you two graphs, and they're both basically 16-year averages from the year 1880 until today. One of them is the temperature over time of the entire planet, Earth's temperature from 1880 to today. The other one is the stock market from 1880 to today, and when you adjust for inflation, right? So first, I'll ask you just to answer this easy, quick question. Are these graphs rising, dropping, or are they flat? Well, this is probably from the Journal of Duh, right? Because everyone who sees this says, well, yeah, they're rising. Now, that should tell you something. If one of these is, both of them look like they're rising, one of them is Earth's surface temperature, and the other one is the Dow Jones Industrial Average, then that probably tells you something about the inference that maybe temperature is indeed rising. Now, as I said, each of these dots are 16-year averages, so there's a little bit of smoothing involved. And I'll talk about the different ways we actually give people information, interventions, and instruction that helps them appreciate global warming that's occurring, that's caused by humans, and that's something that we should actually act on. And so this is what we call our Beck's graphs. And this is like one of the five ways we use to increase that acceptance and understanding. And the cover story is that Bex is an alien robot who lands here by accident, doesn't know what's going on, hears that the stock market may be going up, the temperature may be going up. He doesn't know who to believe. He's listened to the radio. He says, well, I know that if I just average things, it'll tell me the central tendencies. And so from the beauty of averaging, sure enough, he concludes that temperature is going up. And we're not talking about necessarily trivial increases, right? So it turns out that if one of the less than pleasant predictions is true, that we might increase our planet's temperature by 6 degrees Celsius, that in terms of your body, if your body went up 6 degrees, that would be like having a body temperature of about 109.4. And your planets are sensitive to temperature, bodies are sensitive to temperature, so that's not a great scenario, right? So I'm going to pull back now from that phenomenal sense and get more into that a little bit later. But I realize I may not have time to get through everything I'd like to offer. So I'm going to give you an outline just in case something happens or I keel over and they say, what was he going to say again? So this is the aspirational talk that I will probably touch on at least. One thing that's relatively apparent to many people is that the U.S. is different from their peer nations, that the U.S. has a different approach. We're less likely to accept global warming than most of the industrial or post-industrial nations on the planet. And my thought is, well, maybe that's changeable. Maybe we can join the body of other nations. And what you're going to see today is sort of like a psychology in the public interest approach to climate change denial. And one of the keys to this work is that we really don't have any deceptions. So we tell people right up front, the information that I'm going to give you is as true as we know, and you can share with your family tonight. There are no deceptions, unlike like a lot of social psychological experiments where they do have a little deception. And that's often very important. And one of the problems is that people really don't have a lot of knowledge about climate change and global warming. And it's not just true in the United States or San Diego, where we initially started looking at participants. We've assessed this in Germany and Japan and places like that. But the good news is that if you explain the mechanism of global warming, which a lot of people don't know, in as little as 400 words, so in the blue here, you'll see some of the five ways that we increase acceptance of global warming. And we've done about seven or more experiments of this sort with people from California, Texas, Germany, a nationwide sample called MTurk, which you can get on the web. We find that people hugely increase their knowledge about how global warming works, as well as increases the acceptance and concern about global warming. So these more national samples, the MTurk experiments, we also find that we're not turning conservatives off. So there's a fear sometimes you can polarize people, that they have this sort of anti-propaganda kind of reaction where they'll say, oh, you're trying to game me. We don't find that. Generally, conservatives increase their acceptance of global warming just as liberals do, sometimes even a little bit more. So we don't find polarization. And we don't find that people are staying still. They're not static. So I'll talk a little bit about a stasis theory that one person is suggesting, that it's very hard to change people's minds, that people only believe what they want to believe. That turns out not to be true. And the other thing is that they have pretty good longevity. It's not like they leave our experiment and then, you know, 5 minutes later, they're just back to believing what they want to believe. We've tested people up to 34 days later, and we still find the effect of our instruction. So one of the things I'm going to do at this point of the talk, I'll sort of pivot about halfway through the talk toward connecting the work in global warming that I've done with this paradigm I've done for a while called numerically driven inferencing, where people make inferences about numbers that they're seeing often for the first time. And those numbers could be statistics or graphs, things like that. And rarely, but occasionally, we even combine these. So like in one 11th grade chemistry class, we give them both an explanation of the mechanism of global warming from the physical standpoint, as well as also the diagnostic numbers about climate change. And we've run actually three formal experiments where we just give these representative statistics on their own, and it's worked out pretty well in terms of, and these statistics are about the effects of global warming. And you'll see some of these, I'll go through them. We also use some other statistics. Most recently, we've given information about sea level rise, and I'll show you a little bit of that if time permits. And as I mentioned, we give these Beck's graphs to people, and those are quite successful as well. Now, I want to put a plug in for our website, which is howglobalwarmingworks.org. And it's a direct-to-the-public website. It's just there to give information. There's no proselytizing. You just go there for good scientific statistical information. And we're translating into different languages. We've got some Mandarin. We've got videos up there as well, even in Mandarin. So, again, we've got another blue thing, the videos. So these are some of the five of the six ways we've been increasing people's understandings. And we've even been comparing dosages, like how much of like a video that people need to see to be compelled by it and such. So I'll get into that a little bit, and then, of course, conclusions and implications toward the end. But first, I want to get back a little bit to the almost related to the I'm not a commie theme. That is that there's an unfortunate sort of defamation of science that's been going out in some parts of the general public, where they sort of suggest that you can't trust scientists because they're on the take, they just want grants or things like that. And I'd like to talk a little bit about what really motivates scientists, what the motivations are, and I'm going to offer a little pledge. But what are real scientists like? Well, you can see some characteristics up here. So most scientists, especially parents who happen to be scientists, don't want global warming to be true. And they overwhelmingly wish that global warming were false. And especially even if you care about your older self, like what am I going to eat when I'm 95, you know, then you'd care about global warming. The other thing I'd point out is that most PhDs can do other things. It turns out that the unemployment rate is surprisingly low for PhDs, and they have high job satisfaction. So the people who are doing stuff in climate change really could be doing something else. And climate scientists, you know, they still making good pay. And I think it's just really wrong to impugn climate scientists or even climate change communicators to suggest that somehow they're just yes people trying to go along to get along or to, you know, to get another grant or something like that. And because really, if it comes down to it, most scientists are actually reinforced for overcoming or overturning, rather, common paradigms. So Einstein didn't become a Nobel laureate by just saying, that Newton guy, he had a lot of great ideas. I like it. You know, that's just not how you get fame in science. And I personally would just be ecstatic if global warming weren't happening. I'd be very happy for personal reasons, all manners of reasons. So I offer this pledge to you right now that I offer all the audiences I speak to. If someone, after this talk or on the web or whatnot, emails me and tells me that, and can convince me that global warming is false, that is, that I'm just deluded about this, I will be so happy that I would rent the largest SUV I could find, drive to wherever that person is, offer to kiss them if they'd like that, promise that I'd stop doing work in this entirely, and I'd give back any dollar I ever got related to climate change. And in fact, if I thought that for a second that I could actually disconfirm global warming myself, I would do it in a heartbeat. And just about any scientist would, because you'd expect to be known as the most famous scientist ever. I mean, not only that, you'd probably win a Nobel Prize. And also, I'd split half the money with you if you could disabuse me of this and help me win the Nobel Prize. But you know, you would imagine that any bar you'd go into, people would be glad to buy you a beer, right? So you'd be an incredibly popular person if you could do that. So this is my pledge, and I will stick to it. The problem is that there's still a bunch of misleading information that's being offered out there. And a lot of this is cherry-picked. And unfortunately, you've probably seen this in some information that's coming at you, whether it's through the elements of the media or sometimes in advertisements or things like that. And it's often about how scientists are purportedly biased. Well, there's certainly an element of politics involved in global warming, right? And there's what's sometimes called agnotology, which is the spreading of false and misleading information. And also there's this notion that maybe people won't change their minds, they're just gonna believe what they wanna believe, that sort of stasis. And I warrant that we really aren't static, and you'll see some evidence for that as well. And the problem is, of course, that there are some vested interests with financial interests to sow this sort of doubt. And I won't name names, but a lot of politicians rely on this sort of money, but often it's related indirectly or directly to fossil fuel in one way or another. And there are entire companies, and indeed entire countries, that would love to disconfirm global warming. And when you think about it, there just aren't that many people on the planet who would not want to disconfirm global warming, who wishes it weren't true. And often these companies, you know, publicly they might say, oh yes, I think global warming is occurring, but then if you follow the money, they're often trying to spread agnotology. And think about all the nations that would benefit from this. I mean, imagine Russia with its petrostate and Iran, Saudi Arabia, Venezuela, Iraq, even Norway that feels guilt for selling oil. All these countries would be ecstatic if they could just sell more of the petroleum than they're doing. So it's really like the whole world doesn't want this to be true. So the mere fact that climate scientists are banding together and saying, we need to pay attention to this, that should tell you something about the motivations. So, you know, why hasn't someone disconfirmed global warming given that everyone's arrayed against it, right? Well, I suggest that maybe it's not disconfirmable. Maybe it really is what's going on. So the good news is that people in societies do learn. That is, that they're not static. So, for instance, even though he was speaking truth to power, the papal power in this case, Galileo and others, eventually won the day, and we began to realize that we're in a heliocentric solar system. We revolve around the sun rather than vice versa. And also, another instance of this was that in spite of all the tobacco money and all the people that were addicted to nicotine and didn't want to believe that tobacco wasn't so good for you, that was overcome as well, right? So maybe knowledge can help with the planet, with climate, as it did with the cases of planets and smoking. So I think it bears in mind that we should take this into account. And the other thing that I'm going to point out is that there's sort of a false dichotomy that's often presented to ourselves. And I'm going to use as the at least straw person here, Dan Kahan, who sort of suggested you can't change people's minds by giving them information. You can only change it by changing their culture. And I think that's just malarkey. And I'll show why I think that. And actually, Kahan's own data sort of disconfirms that notion. And it's like many dichotomies, they tend to be false, whether in psychology it's the nature-nurture dichotomy of development or something like that. Usually it's always a little bit of both, and this is the case too, that both culture and information are important in terms of determining people's beliefs about global warming and climate change. And Kahn has even vacillated this a bit on speaking about MDs, or he's given people geoengineering information that has already changed their minds. So I'm using him as a bit of a straw man in his case. The other thing I want to point out is that we can fix global warming relatively easily. Now you might say, oh, that sounds pretty pricey, right? Well, it turns out that according to the World Bank's report from last year, we spend about $5.3 trillion as a species just subsidizing fossil fuels. And it turns out that roughly for something maybe a little north of $100 trillion, about 20 times that much roughly, we could just fix global warming, convert the whole planet to fossil fuel, to sustainable fuels and so forth, away from fossil fuels. Now that sounds like a lot, maybe, but not compared to World War II. And you know, we did band together and we fixed the ozone hole, or it's being fixed at this point with international agreements. And it's a lot cheaper than the downsides, because switching to sustainable fuels, as we point out in one of our materials, is a win-win-win-win-win scenario when you include health effects and higher employment and things like that. So we could actually become the greatest generation, you know, or the new greatest generation relative to those that were fighting World War II. So I want to get back a little bit more to the phenomenon, even the physics, in honor of the Neff motif. About global warming, its particular mechanism, how it's happening. And I'd like you to think about this, like how would you explain to someone how global warming is happening? And that, while you're thinking about it, I'm going to problematize it just a little bit for you. So why is it that heat has a hard time getting away from Earth, its surface and its troposphere, which is the atmosphere close to Earth? You might say, shouldn't heat have just as hard a time getting in as it has getting out? Why is there this sort of asymmetry? So what I'd like to do now is actually show a little bit of a video. Most of our longer videos, so it's about 4 minutes, just explains the mechanism of global warming from a physical and chemical perspective. And you can see this yourself at howglobalwarmingworks.org. So I'm going to try and run this, and if the magic works, we'll hear it come up.
You may have heard of global climate change, which is often called global warming. Whether or not people accept that humans are causing global warming, most folks have an opinion about it. But how much do regular people understand the science of climate change? If you were asked to explain how global warming works, could you?
Take a moment to try to explain to yourself how virtually all climate scientists think the Earth is warming.
What is the physical or chemical mechanism? Don't feel bad. If you're anything like the people we've surveyed in our studies, you probably struggled to come up with an explanation. In fact, in one study, we asked almost 300 adults in the U.S., and not a single person could accurately explain the mechanism of global warming at a pretty basic level. This is consistent with larger surveys that have shown that people often lack knowledge about climate change. But how can we make informed decisions without understanding the issues we're debating? Allow us to give you a short explanation of how global warming works. First, Here is how Earth's temperature works without considering how humans influence it. The Earth absorbs light from the sun, which is mostly visible light. To release that light energy, Earth also emits light. But because the Earth is cooler than the sun, it emits lower energy infrared light.
So, Earth's surface essentially transforms most of the visible light it gets from the sun into infrared light.
Greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, such as methane and carbon dioxide, let visible light pass through but absorb infrared light, causing the atmosphere to retain heat. This energy can be absorbed and emitted by the atmosphere many times before it eventually returns to outer space. The added time this energy hangs around has helped keep Earth warm enough to support life as we know it. Without this greenhouse effect, caused by these greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, the Earth's average surface temperature would be about 50 degrees Fahrenheit cooler, which is well below the freezing point for ice. So, how have humans changed things? Since the dawn of the Industrial Age, around the year 1750, atmospheric carbon dioxide has increased by 40%, and methane has almost tripled. These increases cause extra infrared light absorption, meaning an extra greenhouse effect, which has caused Earth to heat above its typical temperature range. In other words, energy that gets to Earth has an even harder time leaving it, causing Earth's average temperature to increase, thus producing global climate change.
In case you're wondering about what makes greenhouse gases special, here are two sentences of slightly technical information. Greenhouse gases, such as carbon dioxide, absorb infrared light because their molecules can vibrate to produce asymmetric distributions of electric charge, which match the energy levels of various infrared wavelengths. In contrast, non-greenhouse gases, such as oxygen, that is O2, don't absorb infrared light because they have symmetric charge distributions even while vibrating.
To wrap up, we'll quickly summarize the mechanism of global climate change. Earth transforms sunlight's visible energy into infrared light, and infrared energy leaves Earth slowly because it's absorbed by greenhouse gases. As people produce more greenhouse gases, energy leaves Earth even more slowly, raising Earth's temperature even more than it has already gone up. That's how global warming happens. This wasn't so hard to understand, right?
In these few minutes, you've hopefully become one of the few people who understand the mechanism of global climate change. Please share this video with others so you can help them understand how global warming works too. Thanks for listening.
The video, and I hope you found it interesting, since now you, the few, the proud, the brave, you can lord it over all your friends, this mechanistic knowledge, right? One of the things that I've done actually is even boiled it down to a simple haiku, and it's not as mellifluous as I'd like, but you can do the whole mechanism basically if you just have it this way. Earth turns sunlight to IR light that's sponged by folks' greenhouse gases glut. Now, I think that's pretty amazing that you can concentrate that down to such a small thing. And I should point out actually that this video was based on our initial work where we gave people a 400-word text. And so here's the 400 words here. Basically, you see a bunch of stuff, the fancy stuff about the molecules being asymmetrical. And then we have a summary and then a shorter summary of only 35 words. And, rhetorically, you'd say, well, Donald Trump occasionally has claimed that this is a hoax, a Chinese hoax in particular at times. So you might wonder, which part of this does Donald Trump not agree with? And someday I hope to ask him. We'll see. But the main point about this is, I hope you kind of get a sense, is you can answer questions like, do atmospheric molecules know up from down? And the answer to that is no, but under some molecules you might think, maybe they would have to do that if your model was incorrect. Another thing it points out is that there's a bonus here, that it explains what greenhouse gases are. You can explain that, what makes a greenhouse gas. And you can even infer, like we mentioned O2, but is nitrogen a greenhouse gas, methane? Well, if you are paying attention and infer, you can actually answer questions like that. Now, the person who actually narrated this is a fellow named David Diggs, who later went on to be one of the stars of Hamilton, and he won a Tony for playing Jefferson and Lafayette. And I really think that I put his career on the right path by letting him do our video, because you can see how it zoomed after that. My daughter actually did the storyboard. Now, you might think, well, this is knowledge that maybe other people do know. Maybe it's not 1 in 300 that know this. Well, it turns out, here's some examples that show that's not quite the case. There's a Berkeley fellow who's about to get a PhD in environmental sciences. He didn't know the answer. I spoke with a colleague who was very upset that he didn't know the answer, and I was trying to console him, and he said, it's not all right that I didn't know. You don't understand. I've published papers about global warming. And indeed, one of the most famous climate change communicators didn't know the mechanism of global warming when I was talking with him once over dinner. Here's a fellow who might have known better, and he's confusing the greenhouse effect with global warming. Effectively, global warming is an extra greenhouse effect on top of the pre-existing natural greenhouse effect that, you know, has made the planet sort of pleasantly toasty, but we don't want to make it too toasty. And of course, this person also brought in ozone, which is actually a misconception that's not really related to climate change to a significant degree. So I thought, well, maybe it's just me, because I didn't initially know this mechanism, and my friends that aren't that sharp. So we actually went to San Diego and we asked almost 300 people, as the video implies. Not a single person knew the mechanism of global warming. Most of them thought it was because of ozone depletion. That was a major cause. We got similar results when we asked our 11th graders, so it wasn't just people on the street, and these were chemistry students. And I find it quite odd that journalists and instructors aren't giving us this information, right? You'd think that this is something that we could learn pretty readily if it's haiku level sort of information. And most importantly, or more importantly, is that global warming acceptance is linked to mechanistic knowledge. We found that empirically, and we even replicated that link in Germany, and we replicated again in the United States. And this conflicts with the sort of the stasis idea that Dan Kahan suggests in this quote here, where he sort of suggests that efforts to promote scientific literacy can't be expected to dissipate public conflict over climate change. But again, he vacillates on that a little bit. And it's not that the San Diegans were denying global warming. Most of them were down with the idea that it's occurring. And almost half of them strongly agreed that humans' activities are a significant cause of global warming. So I thought, as a psychologist, well, duh, it seems like an easy idea to just tell people this mechanism and see if that changes people's minds. So I did that. And I'm going to tell you about an experiment I call the jam experiment. It's really kind of a jam sandwich. And because we're trying to understand if the knowledge actually causes people to accept global warming better, more so, that's an experiment. It's a causal question. So it's a good time to use this thing. And the metaphor basically is the pieces of bread in this sandwich are a pretest and a post-test. And the intervention, our 400 words in this case, was the jam. So the sandwich group looks like this. We give them a pretest and ask them about their knowledge and attitudes. We give them that 400 words as the jam, put on the other slice of bread, and find out their post-test knowledge and attitude. And we ran on other conditions, because I'm a fancy cognitive psychologist. I know how to do decent experiments. But I'll give you the results here on the knowledge case. So here on the left-hand side, you can see we have three different dimensions of understanding this mechanism. The first one is how light is transformed from visible to infrared light, the nature of greenhouse gases, energy dynamics. And you can see on the pretest, before they got this 400-word description, they were running around 22% or so. And then afterwards, they were sort of more than doubled, almost tripled, their understanding of the greenhouse effect, or the global warming. And you say, well, that sounds pretty good. And these were reliably, statistically, and so forth. And remember, why this is interesting is because knowledge does correlate with acceptance. So hopefully they have more knowledge, will they show more acceptance? And so we thought, well, let's see if they accepted it more by virtue of having read these 400 words. And indeed, that's what happened. We first tried this out with Berkeley students and University of Texas Brownsville students, who are 95% Latino. And we've replicated this with non-college students. This is just the first run. And you can see that even both of those groups increased their acceptance of global warming. So the take home so far here is that not only did we show that global warming learning is possible, but also attitude change is possible too. And this clearly disconfirms stasis theory, because you can change people's minds with information. And again, worked with heliocentrism, worked with the smoking cancer link, so that it's following a pattern there, right? And we also noticed that knowledge and acceptance do predict people's willingness to sacrifice. So not just their acceptance, but their potential willingness to act about global warming. And knowledge and acceptance also correlate with environmental attitudes and behavior, as we found in some of our German data. And also we found that we could test them later, and they still had some of these effects. So for instance, in this one study, we had 7 different experiments. Experiment 5 showed that even on delayed post-test, in this case it was like 34 days later, that these 11th graders showed a maintained increased acceptance of global warming. And we've tested this a lot in other experiments too, sometimes like 5.5 days, often 9 days is what we sort of gravitate to. So again, you know, these findings sort of indicate the stasis theory, that people just are going to stick with what they believe, is not true. And as you'll see, we don't even find polarization. That is, it's not like the conservatives among our participants, you know, were reticent or even had sort of a backfire effect. And you can see this by looking at some of the numbers even across political parties. So change in acceptance was not negatively correlated, was not negative for conservative political party members. So in the blue here, you can see the immediate post-test, and all these are positive. So people increased their acceptance. This was on a 9-point scale. And then 9 days later in green, you can see all these different party members also increased their acceptance. And this is in a pretty large survey. This is a more recent one where we had 1,100 participants. So, you know, they were maintaining. It wasn't like they were dropping off. And indeed, this correlation was actually the opposite of what you would expect if there was polarization. There were polarization, because conservatives were actually increasing their acceptance of global warming a little bit more than the liberals were. So that was pretty positive. And, you know, you can actually contrast this with sometimes what politicians might know. When I've been here, I've been asked several times, what do you think different politicians know about the mechanism of global warming? Well, I can tell you what one politician said on May 5th, 2016, when this one was speaking to a coal community. This is one of the 2 highest polling candidates for US president last year. You can guess which one this might have been, but I'll sort of give you a sense. So this person said, I said to the climate scientist, wait a minute. So if I take hairspray and I spray it in my apartment, which is all sealed, you were telling me that that affects the ozone layer? Yes? I say, no way, folks, no way. So you can guess who this person is, but this person is on the web. You can check this out between 5 minutes and 53 and 608 of this address. And what does that mean? I mean, was it Hillary? You figure out. What does it say about this person's understanding of gases? Does that mean that after the hairspray is sprayed, that the molecules just fall on the floor, and then the housekeeper sweeps them up and then puts them in the dustbin? Or that this person actually believes that the apartment is hermetically sealed, and that there's no like ventilation system? You know, that might explain, the carbon monoxide might explain this quote, actually. But, you know, I'm not saying, but maybe someone knows something about building buildings and might put in a ventilation system. And also, ozone is not a part of the problem, as I mentioned before, right? So that's sort of this contrast between what people might know and what politicians even might know. So I want to pivot again at this point and say a little bit about how we run statistics here with numerically driven inferencing. And at this point, I'll give you a little sense. So what we do is we ask people for estimates of particular numbers, like how much we've changed our methane concentration. You've seen this, but a lot of people might think, oh, it's only gone up 5%. But what would they think if the answer were that we've almost tripled it? And you might think, well, maybe they'd give more money to stop climate change. So we ran another experiment where, in this case, we had a double-decker jam sandwich. And one layer of jam was a bunch of statistics we asked people to estimate, and then we give them feedback on it, which is the second layer. And we'd see, well, maybe just learning what these statistics are about global warming increases their acceptance. And I'll pass a card out in a little bit with these on this, so you don't have to belabor these too much. But these are pretty compelling, I think. These are just 3 out of the 9 we sometimes use. The first one is that 98% of climate scientists are already down that it's causing the majority of global warming, that humans are. That for every 100 record colds we have in the United States, instead of having 100 record highs like you'd think, we're getting 204 record highs. If you look back in the past 30 years, basically every single month of the past 30 years, that month has had a higher average temperature than the average from the 20th century. And I actually got this idea from some work I did with journalists, where I gave them 40 top numbers that everyone should know, but most people don't. Even people from Fukushima that have a bit more skin in the game don't know the effects of global warming as well as they should. They underestimate them. And what we found is by giving people these statistics after they estimate them, that also increases people's acceptance of global warming. And again, with no polarization, the conservatives are moving up as well. And in fact, even 9 days later, we've decreased denial of global warming by 28%. So that's another way in which people have changed their views. And I might just show this, that this is how summer temperatures have been moving. So from 1951 to 1980, you can see the distribution of summer temperatures where the cold days are really just cool summer days. But you know, if you move a few decades on to look from 2005 to 2015, you can see, like in that statistic number two, how we're getting hotter. So I want to remind you of a little bit of the Beck stories that we gave. I won't belabor this so much in the interest of time, but I can tell you that we tried 10 different of those conditions where we were comparing the temperature over time to the stock market over time. Every single one of those 10 conditions worked really quite well. I won't belabor you with the particular design. And even 9 days later, people had increased gains regarding acceptance of global warming. And the groups that got the most information, that were closer to like 5 minutes of information, decreased their denial of global warming by 26% just by looking at these graphs and ruminating about them. And at the extreme, if you did 64-year moving averages, they look like jet planes taking off, right? So if you average them even more, it's pretty clear which way temperature and the stock market are going, right? And I won't belabor this too much. So these other interventions led to this website, howglobalwarmingworks.org, direct to the public, and I'll ask some minions to pass out some cards. I didn't want to do beforehand, but there's our little 35-word mechanism on one side, and the other side has the seven of our statistics, and you can take the quiz and then look at the answers later and share that with your friends. I hope you'll do that. And I won't belabor this too much, but our hope is that, you know, by these sorts of bits of information, we can make global warming as obvious it is to people that they're living on a spherical planet. That's the hope. So please pass around the link, how global warming works, to all of your friends. It's been pretty successful so far. We've had about 300,000 native page views, 200 countries, 20,000 towns. People from those different places have been coming. If you include what people have just written about our stuff, it's over 1 million page views. We've been analyzing comments from folks. We have a Chinese version I'll mention. And on this website, you can also find not only our videos, we have a short video of like only 52 seconds. So if you have a friend who has a very short attention span, only like time for a cat video, then you can give them the 52-second video. We put some Beck graphs of them. You can show them as well. This is kind of what the website looks like. You can see the five different videos you could click on depending upon your desire. And I think I'll skip over this about why we think conceptually from a cognitive science point it's useful. But I'll also mention that we're translating this into different languages. So like Mandarin, we have videos in Mandarin and Czech and German with audio and labels. We're moving toward getting more translation so that when you click on the closed captioning, Google Translate gives you a better translation, or YouTube gives you a better translation than Google Translate would have for that particular language. Because you might imagine, like, Japanese Google Translate isn't necessarily the best, and indeed, so we're overriding that. We could use help with others who want to help us translate them. This is a snapshot of what the Chinese website looks like, and you can see the Mandarin videos there you could click on as well. And I think I'll mention this last experiment where we were trying to do, like, a consumer reports sort of experiment. We were wondering, well, how would these things compete against each other if we were going to compare the statistics to our videos and whatnot? And I won't belabor this too much, but these were statistically significant both immediately on the post-test, like right after they finished watching the video or seeing the statistics. You can see that with the asterisk, which ones of those were statistically significant. And for really short ones, like our, you know, 1.2-minute video or something like that, that may be too small of a dosage, or maybe we didn't run enough participants is another way to think about it. But our 5-minute video is very compelling. Our 596 words, which are the transcript of that 5-minute video, is very compelling. Our 9 statistics are compelling. And even 9 days later, you can see that we get virtually no drop-off for those things that are statistically significant, which are the longer things, that we get very little drop-off, no significant drop-off at all. And we had some control groups that I won't belabor, but again, it was pretty good science, so we were doing the right things. And one thing I can point out is that it's really important to ask people right after the intervention is over, because it helps consolidate that in their memory. If you test them 9 days later and you didn't give them an immediate post-test right afterwards, then they're not changed as much, because there's this stuff that goes on at night between your hippocampus and your cortex. It's important to have that sort of like extra practice after you've seen something. The other thing I could say is that one weird phenomenon we found, that even people who got our control video that doesn't say anything about the mechanism of the video, 9 days later, they knew more about the mechanism. And we can only presume that they went and Googled it afterwards and say, what is that mechanism anyway? Because, you know, the control was like, hey, people don't know the mechanism of global warming. Isn't that bad? Shouldn't they know this? Well, see you later, you know? And so they had curiosity. And even the people who got our 9 statistics that don't address the mechanism of global warming, they also knew more about global warming's mechanism later. So they were looking into it on the web as well. So I'll tell you a little bit about our last and most recent thing. We've looked actually at sea level rise, and we've run this little intervention that basically, I'll just gloss over this a little, but it says that there's a big financial risk to sea level rise, especially in Florida, as you see here. And this was all done well before I knew Hurricane Irma was coming, right? We ran this this summer. And it turns out that people are kind of voting with their feet. I won't go through each one of these. But in general, in many different ways, people, the property that is close to the ocean is increasing in value slower than property that's away from the ocean. So people are already sort of building the idea, like, well, why should I buy this if in 10 years I can't sell it because it's underwater? So people are voting with their pocketbooks. And there are two scenarios we also gave people about different sea level rises in South Florida, as it turns out. So timely, but unfortunately so, I'm afraid. So this is what Florida looks like if there's a 1 degree increase in Celsius rise, is what a 77-foot sea level rise would result from a 1 degree Celsius sea level rise. And you can see the Everglades are gone. Most of the cities that are on the coast, this won't show that too well, but like Miami, Palm Beach, Sarasota, things like that, they'll be underwater with just a 1 degree increase in temperature when that reaches homeostasis. With a 4 degree rise in temperature, it'd be a 29-foot rise. And so even Tampa would be underwater at that point. And so you can kind of get a sense that this has really serious implications. And Miami today, even on a blue day, will have some blue sky flooding when the tide is high. Well, the worst case scenario is if all the ice on the planet melted, we'd actually get like a 214-foot rise in sea level. And the southeast United States would look something like this. The only upside I can imagine is that Kansas State would be about 6 hours drive from the shoreline. So you could visit the ocean in Arkansas. That would be one. But it would be pretty bad for the United States, and God knows what we'd be eating by then, right? So I put a slide like this in just because a lot of times I get asked, well, what should I do? And I was reticent to preach anything about this. But if you're curious, one thing is to tell your representatives and senators what you feel about climate, about the climate. Vote for people who will inhibit global warming the most quickly. And more locally, you can do these things. You might consider having one fewer child than otherwise you might, even one fewer dog or cat, actually. You could eat food that generates fewer greenhouse gases. So you don't have to be vegan, but you could eat less lamb, less beef, less non-canned shellfish. Maybe not dig up so much stuff. So a lot of earth has to be moved for a small amount of gold. And diamonds are actually quite plentiful. It's just a false a sense that they're rare. It's a built-in sort of monopoly, basically. And these folks actually suggested some other things you can do on the home front, including, you know, obviously getting a vehicle that's a little better, insulating, carpooling, changing those light bulbs, keeping your car in good shape. And we have this slogan that in the end, you know, a lot of people who deny global warming think that, well, this isn't such of a worry, but, and, you know, we have this notion that history will not be kind to those people who intentionally deceive people about climate change, and we're deniers intentionally, and so it's something to keep in mind. Anyway, I'll dive into the conclusions, because I'm sure I've come close to testing your attention. I'll just hop to the green things here. So basically, we found that global warming acceptance is replicably linked to both knowledge and willingness to sacrifice about global warming. And if folks rarely know the greenhouse gas, extra greenhouse gas mechanism that represents global warming, but people can learn it really quickly. Hopefully, you've learned it in about 4 minutes. They can do it in 400 words. We have these videos available, and we see gains in acceptance about global warming just by people viewing our words or watching our videos. We can point out that it seems critical to get people to put their cards on the table and actually estimate the statistics or think about what the mechanism is before they get feedback, or else they get this hindsight bias where they self-charitably say, yeah, I would have thought something like that. I can't tell you how many people think they know the mechanism of global warming and then find out that they do not. And, you know, we give statistics to people to help them understand the situation with representativeness, representative statistics. We think the Beck's graphs are pretty cool with bringing in the idea of comparing temperature to the stock market. And I hope you will agree with me now that stasis theory is rejected. There's people do change when they get information, and we don't get polarization, that our conservatives are moving up just as well as our liberals. And the latest studies sort of suggest that it's important to get an immediate post-test where people get tested on the information right after they get it. We think there is a sixth way where we give people this sixth way to help people change their minds with giving them information about sea level rise. A seventh way is to show how inexpensive it is to switch over from fossil fuels. An eighth way is to explain why you should trust scientists. And the basic goal here is to get enough of the population toward tipping points where they accept global warming fast enough so we can get all the nations of the planet to agree internationally to do something about this problem. And there are 7.5 billion people, right? And they need help from scientists, including cognitive scientists like myself. We think that how global warming works is part of that help, and I'd encourage you to send people to it. And finally, you know, we have these other languages, and I hope you'll look at that. And I'll just show this slide while I'm wetting my whistle, so you can see the five ways that we change people's minds. So this is good timing, because I'm going to stop here and just say thanks a bunch.
You okay?
I am.
Well, thank you, Dr. Ranney. We have time for some questions. And in order that we can get the questions also in our video system, et cetera, I'd like to ask you to keep the questions relatively brief so that Dr. Ranney can repeat the question and then answer the question.
Why don't you yell it and I'll try to repeat it.
So, what about selective exposure? So, you know, it sounds like in your experiments people are allowing themselves to be exposed to the information because, say, they're in an experiment or something like that. But a lot of people that have either a liberal or conservative stance on many issues, such as global warming, tend to only expose themselves to information from groups that they agree with. So, for example, if you're conservative, you may watch Fox News or read Breitbart, and if you're liberal, you may watch MSNBC or Huffington Post or New York Times. And so if you only go to news sources that are consistent with your beliefs, you may not even be exposed to the kinds of information that you're showing can change people's attitudes.
Right, so generally the question, if I could summarize it, is about self-siloization, where people tend to silo themselves into particular news sources, whether it's their Facebook feeds or Twitter feeds, or they only watch particular television shows. And there is an asymmetry here. I should say that liberals and conservatives don't silo themselves to the same degree, but it is a difficulty. And so you have to wonder, like, how do these experiments, how would they scale up in the real world, out in the wild, right? So it's certainly the case that you can't just grab a random person and say, you have to watch this video. And but there are ways to make inroads with that. So let's say that you're sitting in a bar, and the person next to you says, oh, so you accept global warming. I don't even think you know how that works. Tell me how that works. And if you haven't seen our video, most people would say, well, but you know, my professor says that it's happening. And the other person says, oh yeah, well, my radio commentary host says it's not happening. So at that point, you sort of have this loggerheads. But if you do, if you can explain the mechanism, you can better articulate your case. You can change minds in that moment, in that bar, by saying, look, this is what's happening with the infrared light, right? So in respects, like, the mechanism is very potent because it's kind of a tiebreaker. Imagine you went to another culture that had never seen a toilet, and you were trying to explain it, and that, you know, let's say that the chief is being advised by the spiritual leader and says, oh, don't believe them, he's just talking to this fancy technology so they can get better trade terms for our pelts. But you say, no, so you go to a riverbank and you draw into the, here's a bowl up here, and there's a tank on top of it, there's a conduit here that's a little like a river, that's how it works. You know, eventually, maybe you have to call down to Recife and have them bring up a little model of it, or, you know, eventually, hopefully you wouldn't have to, like, haul up in an actual toilet. But it's sort of a tiebreaker. So it's certainly the case that the siloization is a problem. But among people, if you get more and more of a population to understand how to articulate it, I think things will improve by on the basis of that. Other questions? Yes.
So I'm wondering, from the time scale, a new idea, how quickly society shifts over to that. And I suppose maybe it's a 30-year time scale.
Mm. Well, if it's 30 years, then global warming is a bigger problem than I fear. I mean, you can sort of look at some things like the controversy or ex-controversy about, the question was, will it take 30 years, as is the proposition, to change people's minds about global warming, just to sort of bluntly say that. So how long did it take for people to decide that smoking wasn't good for people? Well, you know, there are initial inklings, but, you know, a long time there were even physicians saying, ah, I think it's good for you, right? And it took a while for the science to build up, and it's more complicated science in some respects. So anything you can do in a haiku, I think, is pretty simple. So I'm hoping it'll be a lot faster than 30 years. And also it's dynamic, right? Like, it's changing all around us. And in 30 years, it should be very apparent. And so I imagine that that'll convince people right there. Yeah.
I'm surprised that people don't know the greenhouse effect. That's something that I thought was taught in physical science. I taught in physical science at college level. Also, when you teach black body radiation, you teach why would be cold if you didn't have an atmosphere. I think it's the other problem. So I'm wondering, for people that don't want to know how global warming works, but they might be interested to know why their car gets hot on the inside or how a greenhouse works, if you can get to 90% of the explanation with that, is that a way to entice people that aren't really, they don't believe in global warming, so they don't want to talk about that, but they might be interested in other phenomenon that, oh, and by the way, with a little extra,
you can
get a little hotter.
Right. So the question is sort of, on the first part, implicitly sort of, this has been taught to some people. Why don't they remember it? And why it's not compelling? And would an analogy with a car on a hot day be a good one? So I think that one of the problems with climate education is that most people tend to give people a blizzard of information. So there are so many fancy terms like albedo, radiative forcing, that we don't use. We think that there's one really important bit of science that they need to know about global warming, and that's that that mechanism. It turns out a lot of people don't know a lot of things. Like if you ask people why the Earth is spherical, most people can't answer that, haven't been asked it, have to think about it for a long time. So I think that part of the difficulty is we give too much stuff and they have to pick from this blizzard of information what's most important, and I think the mechanism is the most important. As for the analogy, we don't actually use analogies because all analogies fail at some point. The atmosphere isn't quite like a car on a hot day. It's certainly not like a blanket. So we try to avoid that and just say what really is going on rather than use some analogy, because psychological studies show that oftentimes if you don't understand the analog, that's not going to, the source analog, it's not going to help you understand the target analog. And a lot of people don't understand what's going on in a hot car anyway, so you're actually just building more complexity into the explanation if you use that. But some people love analogies more than I do, and they might disagree with that, but that's at least the short answer. Thank you. Yeah.
So I teach global warming in my chemistry classes.
Great.
And I try to let the students understand it. And so one of the things that your paper does, or your video doesn't show, mm-hmm. or doesn't say, is that the largest absorber of IR radiation in the atmosphere is water, large extent.
Yeah.
And any well-trained climate denier will immediately come and follow you with the information you gave them and say, look, water is the biggest thing. These other gases can really trace amounts, just doubling, tripling, quadrupling them shouldn't make a difference.
Right.
And so, and then at that point, the person with the 35-word explanation doesn't have a good comeback, and you need a lot more knowledge at that point to essentially educate the denier, and even at that point, they're probably not going to change their mind. So have you tried an experiment where you've actually given them a climate denier argument and see if they can counter that argument?
We haven't done that yet. The question is, a common refrain from deniers is, you're not talking about water vapor, that's a gigantic absorber of infrared light. Water is good for us, come on. You're trying to sell us a load of goods here, right? And why we don't mention that, and would we be interested in using that? So one of the downsides of addressing misconceptions is that you have to lend tongue to them first. So for people who don't know about the water, why would we bring that up for people? It's kind of like in physics, when I've done physics education, if someone doesn't have an impetus model misconception, then I don't think it's a good idea for me to announce it, because you never know if 5 years later they're going to remember the impetus misconception or they're going to remember inertia as a way to do it. I mean, imagine in 10, 20 years, people are going to ask, was Obama a Muslim? And so often, no matter how often you say, Obama is not a Muslim, Obama is not a Muslim, what's being associated is Obama Muslim, Obama Muslim. And so, you know, who knows what's going to be remembered later on. So I think there's a danger in addressing misconceptions that don't exist. What we thought about would be useful on our website is to have like an FAQ sort of page where you say, if you're concerned about water vapor, click here. And then they could go to that or other things like, if you're confused about thinking that maybe Earth is supposed to be in an instantaneous equilibrium with the cosmos and therefore climate change is impossible, click here. So we could do that in various ways, but also if you bring up a misconception, you're bringing in a lot more information, and that's confusing them when all they really need to know is this. So if they come across a denier, then they can look up and they can see, well, sure, water vapor is a huge absorber, but it's already sucked up all the wavelengths of infrared light that it's going to. And a big problem with methane is it's like a newer entry into the cornucopia of greenhouse gases, and so it's beginning to suck up infrared light that hasn't been sucked up. So there's, you know, different molecules have different wavelengths that it absorbs. So I think it's a really important question, but I think that tactically addressing it, at least if it hasn't been raised, is not necessarily a good thing. And there's also the question later, like, what are they going to remember? Are they going to remember the proper thing or the thing that we were trying to debunk? And cognitive psychology has not been kind to those people who think that they'll remember the right thing, that often people remember the most available thing. Yeah?
I guess I just want to offer one cautionary note, and that is that sometimes I see people who want to share a message like this, they'll beat someone about the head and shoulders with it and make them feel like an idiot,
yeah,
which immediately makes them shut down and not listen to the argument.
I hope I haven't done that.
So I think, you know, I'm just concerned right. that sometimes people might forward this link to
right.
someone and say, here's for you idiots out there who don't believe in global warming. That immediately yeah. is going to mean they're not going to go through it.
Well, you know, unfortunately, I can't change. The question is, you know, what about people who are going to use this to bludgeon people that they don't like or trying to harsh? And that is a difficulty. In fact, when we look at our comments, you know, we get private comments, and so we look at what people say, but there are also public comments, like NPR.org did a piece on our thing that got over 100,000 page views just about our stuff. This one article was just on our stuff. And the comments are public, and they say really unkind things, like, you know, this shows that this political party is peopled with idiots. And that is a difficulty. And I'm not sure exactly how to go around that other than like putting caveats like, be kind with this information. Don't be a jerk. You know, these are people too, even if they don't agree with you. So maybe we should consider that a little bit more than we do. But I guess, you know, in the sense of urgency, we haven't spent as much time thinking about that as we probably should. Yeah, it's a great question.
Well, in the interest of being kind and gentle to our speaker,
sure.
why don't we thank him and let him escape?
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.